Hi, this is Dr. G, and let's talk about related rates. So whether you're learning related rates for the very first time, or you're feeling a bit lost and confused, or you just want a quick review, in this video, I'll go over everything that you need to know about related rates. Let's go.
Suppose there's a cone that's expanding in size, or a ladder that's sliding down a wall.
In both scenarios, something's happening that's causing changes in either measurements or dimensions that are specific to each scenario.
For example, as the cone is getting bigger, the radius of the circular base is increasing as well, along with the volume of the cone and the surface area. Not only are they all getting bigger, but they're related to each other as well. We can relate the changes of the radius with the changes in the volume or the changes in the surface area, or we can relate the changes in the volume with the surface area. For the scenario with the falling ladder, we can denote the height of the tip of the ladder as X and the distance between the base of the ladder and the wall as Y. As you can see, before the ladder starts to fall, X is very big compared to Y. However, as the ladder starts to fall down, X decreases while Y increases. Again, we see changes in both X and Y, and as you probably guessed, they're related to each other. So what's related rates? In a nutshell, related rates problems involve two variables that are related to each other, meaning they're connected within a mathematical equation. And both variables are changing with respect to time, hence the term rates in related rates. Every related rates question asks you to find the same thing, which is the rate of change of one of the two variables.
The thing about related rates problem is that although some of them might seem quite difficult and tricky, they all follow the same generic pattern and routine. And once you have it down, trust me, these problems won't be much of a problem for you at all.
So let's break down related rates. As we already know, there will be two variables, let's say X and Y, that are related with each other in a sense that they can be found within a single equation. And once the proper equation has been determined, we will need to do something called implicit differentiation with respect to time.
By the time you're learning related rates, you've probably been already introduced to implicit differentiation. However, the implicit differentiation done in related rate problems is slightly different due to the fact that it's done with respect to time. How do you do that? Or what does that even mean? Don't worry, I got you. I'm going to go over all the basic fundamentals of implicit differentiation in just a second.
Okay, back where we left off. As you can see, once we perform implicit differentiation, both variables are still there, but we also unlock two more things. We unlock dx over dt, which is the rate of change of our x variable, and dy over dt, which is the rate of change of our y variable. Along with the two variables, the question will always supply us with one rate of change, let's say in this case dx over dy, and will ask us to solve for the other rate of change algebraically. There might be cases where there seems like there are three related variables, let's say x, y, and z, which would mean after implicit differentiation, we would unlock an extra rate of change, dz over dt. However, that won't happen because related rate problems would only have two rates of changes, which means there can only be two variables. The third variable in this case would actually be a constant that never changes. So instead of a variable called z, it's actually just a constant, we can say c. And since constants never change, there is no such thing as a rate of change of our constant. And like always, you'll be provided with one of the rate of changes along with all the other values that you need, and will be tasked to solve for the second rate of change. In this case, it could be finding dx over dt. Okay, so now we have a general idea of how related rates problems work. Let's shift our focus to a more technical aspect. What is implicit differentiation and how do we do it? Let's take a look at this simple quadratic function, y is equal to 2x squared. The relationship between the two variables is explicit. That means we have isolated the y variable so we know exactly what our y variable is equivalent to in terms of x.
And it's important that it's the y variable that's isolated and not the x variable.
Because our y variable is our dependent variable, while our x variable is the independent variable.
In other words, as long as we have our dependent variable y isolated, then we know explicitly what our dependent variable y is equal to in terms of our x, which is the independent variable.
If we're asked to differentiate this, we're really trying to differentiate our dependent variable y with respect to our independent variable x. Therefore, we can put the d over dx beside the y. Notice that it's over dx, which is our independent variable, and it's always that case. And since we explicitly know that y is equal to 2x squared, taking the derivative of y is the same thing as taking the derivative of 2x squared, so we're going to put d over dx beside the 2x squared as well. Notice we're always differentiating with respect to our independent variable, which in this case is x. There's not much we can do with the left-hand side of d over dxy, so what we can do is focus on the right-hand side, which we can easily differentiate using the power rule. Using the power rule will give us 4x, and the left-hand side stays as d over dxy. Note that the 4x is the actual derivative, while d over dxy is just the derivative notation. There are many different derivative notations that all represent the same things. But here's the key. If, for whatever reason, we don't know what the derivative is, we can replace it with this derivative notation, since they're both equivalent to each other anyway. Sure, the derivative notation doesn't really mean anything mathematically, but you will see that this little technique will play a big role when it comes to implicit differentiation. Let's take a look at this function. Even though we still have two variables, x and y, the relationship between y, our dependent variable, and x, our independent variable, is now implicit. That's because we don't have our y isolated, so we don't know exactly what y is equal to. Well, you might be thinking, let's try to isolate y. And we can do that, but you can see when we have to square root both sides to isolate y, it can either be positive or negative on the right-hand side. This ambiguity means that we don't really know what our dependent variable y truly is with respect to x. So if we want to differentiate y, we would need to do so implicitly. We're going to be consistent and still take the derivative of each term with respect to x, our independent variable, so we put d over dx beside every single term. It's important to remember that we always differentiate with respect to the independent variable. Now let's focus on the right-hand side, the 36. No matter what we're trying to differentiate with respect to, 36 is a number, a constant, and the derivative of a constant is always zero. And looking at the left, we're differentiating x squared with respect to x, so that's simple, we just have to use the power rule and we get 2x. But now we have to differentiate the y squared. We can first tackle the squared problem by using the power rule and turning it into 2y, but we haven't fully differentiated y yet, have we? In order to differentiate y, we need to know what it's equal to, but we don't. But we can't actually differentiate y because we don't really know what y is equal to with respect to x because it's ambiguous. So since we don't know the derivative, we can replace it instead with its derivative notation, which is just dy over dx. If you think about it, it's kind of like the chain rule. The 2y solves the problem of the y squared, and the dy over dx is the derivative notation of y because we don't know what the actual derivative of y is. So here you can see the result of differentiating this equation implicitly. Now we have an idea on what implicit differentiating is all about. Let's see how it's slightly different in the context of related rates problems. Let's take a look at this equation again. And just like earlier, we have x and y as our two variables. Except when it comes to related rate problems, both variables in this equation are dependent variables. What are they dependent on? They're both dependent on the same independent variable, which is time. However, the relationships between x and time, as well as y and time, are implicit, which makes sense considering we don't even see time in the actual equation. But we still need to differentiate this, and when we differentiate it, it will be with respect to our independent variable, which is time. And as you expected, we're going to have to do this implicitly because we don't even see time in the equation. And we don't know what x is equal to in terms of time, nor do we know what y is equal to in terms of time. So just like always, we're going to differentiate every single one of our terms with respect to our independent variable, in this case is time, so we put d over dt in front of every single term. Again, the number 36 will always become zero when we differentiate it because it's just a constant. And now looking at d over dt of x squared, we can do the power rule of x squared to get 2x, but again, we don't know the derivative of x because we don't know what x is in terms of time. So instead, we're going to use the derivative notation, which is dx over dt. And we're going to do the exact same thing with the y, giving us 2y dy over dt. Notice that when we implicitly differentiate x and y with respect to time, we will always end up getting dx over dt, which is the rate of change of the x variable, and dy over dt, which is the rate of change of the y variable. And here you can see this is what we get after differentiating this equation implicitly with respect to time. So now we know the typical structure and patterns when it comes to related rates problems, and we also know how to do implicit differentiating that's needed in solving related rates problems. Let's put this to test and practice looking for variables and rates of changes for each variables from example questions. Take a look at this question. A thin circular metal disc changes in size, but not shape, when heated. The disc is being heated so that its radius is increasing at a rate of 0.03 millimeters per second. How fast is the area of the disc changing when the radius is 200 millimeters? Our first task is to figure out what are the two variables here. And by looking at the question, it should be the radius, r, and the area, a. What equation can link the radius and area? Well, it will be the equation of the area of a circle, which is a equals to pi r squared. And once we do implicit differentiation, we're going to unlock dr over dt and dA over dt. Looking at the question, it tells us that the radius is increasing at a rate of 0.03 millimeters per second. That's got to be our dr over dt. And they're asking how fast is the area of the disk changing, which means they're looking for dA over dt. And when it comes to the variables r and a, they tell us that the radius is 200 millimeters, which means that's our r value. And we can easily find the a value by using the equation a equals to pi r squared and plugging in 200 into r. But in this case, we don't really need it, and I'll show you why when we actually do this question later on. And as expected, we're given or can easily find three of the four things, and we're asked to find the rate of change of one of the variables, which in this case is a change in the area. Okay, let's take a look at another question. A 10 meter long ladder is leaning against a vertical wall with its other end on the ground. The top end of the ladder is sliding down off the wall. When the top end is 6 meters above the ground, it is sliding down at 2 meters per second. How fast is the bottom of the ladder moving away from the wall at this instant? To better picture this, let's draw a diagram with a ladder leaning against the wall. The question says that the top end of the ladder is sliding down the wall like this, which means, of course, that the bottom of the ladder would be sliding away from the wall. That makes sense. To make things easier, let's replace the ladder and the wall with a triangle, where x represents the height of the top of the ladder, and y represents the distance between the wall and the bottom of the ladder, and z will represent the ladder itself. At first look, it looks like three variables, and of course, they're linked together by the Pythagorean theorem equation x squared plus y squared equals z squared. But the ladder is 10 meters long, and that's never going to change. So our z is actually 10, which means we don't have three variables. We have two variables, x and y, and z is actually a constant, which is 10. Now let's picture the ladder sliding downwards. It will result in something that looks like this. And if we compare this to the previous picture, we can see that the x value is actually getting smaller as the ladder is dropping down. That is our dx over dt. And as the ladder is sliding downwards, we can see that the y is getting bigger. That is our dy over dt. So with implicit differentiation, we unlock dx over dt and dy over dt as we expected. The question says that the top of the ladder is sliding down at 2 meters per second. So our dx over dt would be negative 2 meters per second because it's going downwards. And the question is asking how fast is the bottom of the ladder moving away, which means that is our dy over dt that they want to know. It tells us that the top end of the ladder is 6 meters from the ground, which means that's our x value, which is 6. And to find the y value, we can just plug in 6 and 10 into the Pythagorean theorem and solve for y. And now we know 4 of the 5 things, and we just have to solve for dy over dt. Because related rates problems are always word problems, it's important to know which equations to use because you're going to be using implicit differentiation on those equations to finish the problem. There's 4 different types of related rates problems that require their own special equations, starting with Pythagorean theorem problems. In this case, you will always get a diagram that looks like a right angle triangle where we have A, B, and C. And of course, the equation we use is A squared plus B squared equals C squared, just like that ladder against the wall problem we just did. Next, we can get trigonometric ratio problems. In trig ratio questions, you'll also get a right angle triangle, except in this case, we shift our attention to the angle and the rate of change of that angle. The equations we use will be either tan theta, sine theta, or cos theta. Next, we can have similar triangle questions, typically a shadow question as someone's walking away from a lamp. In these cases, we will have two triangles that are similar, and you can label the sides of the big triangle as big A and big B, and a small a over small b for the little triangle. And for the equation, you can set it up as ratios of the big triangle to the small triangle. Lastly, we have questions involving volume and area. And the questions will require equations to find the surface area or volume or area of different shapes, such as the ones you see on the screen, or any other shape like these. Before we go over some specific examples together, let's look at a general approach to related rates problems. This first step should always be to find the appropriate equation. Let's say we have a Pythagorean theorem equation. The second step would always be to do implicit differentiation to unlock your dx over dt and dy over dt. But because there's always two variables, one of the variables, let's say in this case z, is actually not a variable and a constant, so it becomes a zero when we derive it.
Keep in mind that in Pythagorean situations, it's not always the hypotenuse or z that's the constant. In certain cases, it could be x and z that are the variables, and the y value could be a constant.
Next, let's take a look at the variables. We're always going to be given one variable, which means in step 3, we're going to have to solve for the other variable with the original equation. However, keep in mind that not all questions require step 3, because not all questions require you to solve for the other variable. And we're going to see an example of that coming right up. And as for the rates of changes, again, we're only going to be given one. So in the final step, or step four, we're going to have to solve for either dx over dt or dy over dt using algebra. All right, now let's go back to that same circular metal disk question. I know we've already broken it down earlier, but let's start this question from scratch. The first step is to find the appropriate equation. By looking at this question, that we see that we have a circular metal disk, and they're asking for the area of a disk. So we know the equation that we have to use is going to be the area of a circle, which makes sense because radius is also a part of that equation. So we know we're doing the right thing. The second step is implicit differentiation. So we're going to take this equation and we're going to implicitly differentiate it with respect to time. And by doing that, we're going to get something that looks like this. The a variable becomes a 1 via the power rule. And of course, we have to put dA over dt because we don't know the actual derivative of a. And as for the r squared, it becomes 2r with the power rule. And then we put dr over dt because we don't know the derivative of r with respect to time. Once we've implicitly differentiated our equation, now we can try to plug in some of the values that we know. In the question, it says that the radius is increasing at a rate of 0.03 millimeters per second, which is our dr over dt. And it says that the radius is 200 millimeters, which is our r value. Now remember, step three said to use the original equation to find the other variable, but we actually lost the other variable, a, when we did the power rule because it became a 1. So we don't need to do the step three in this case. And lastly, they're asking for how fast the area is changing, which is our dA over dt, which is essentially step four, which is to solve for one of the rates of changes. So we easily isolate and solve for dA over dt, which is 12 pi. Let's look at a ladder question again. Again, we've already broken down this question earlier, but let's do this question from scratch. Step one, find the appropriate equation. And since we know that this is a ladder leaning against a vertical wall, we can see that we can turn it into a right triangle with x, y, and z, x being the height of the ladder, y being the distance between the base of the ladder from the wall, and z being the length of the ladder. And the equation relating all three of these would be, of course, the Pythagorean theorem. Which brings us to step two, which is implicitly differentiating our equation, which gives us something that looks like this. Remember, we can't have three variables and three rates of changes. That means in this case, since the ladder is just 10 meters long, we don't have a dz over dt, meaning the z variable, which is a 10 meter long ladder, isn't actually a variable and it's not changing, which is a zero, which makes the entire right-hand side a zero. We could have also looked at this question this way. When we had the Pythagorean equation, instead of keeping it as z, we know that the ladder is 10 meters long, so we replace it with 10, and 10 squared is just 100. And when we implicitly differentiate this, the 100 becomes a zero because it's a constant, which is the same as what we had earlier. Regardless, this is our equation now, and let's see what we know from the question. The top end of the ladder is 6 meters above the ground, which means that is our x. And the ladder is sliding downwards at 2 meters per second, which means our dx over dt is negative 2. How fast is the bottom of the ladder moving? Which means they're asking us for dy over dt, which means now we have to figure out what our y variable is, which brings us to step three, which is to use the original equation to solve for the unknown variable, in this case, the y. Taking the information that we know from the question, we know that at the moment, x is 6 and our ladder is always 10. And using the Pythagorean theorem, which is the original equation, we can solve for y, which is 8. Now that we know y is 8, we can plug it in into y, and now we can try to use algebra to isolate for dy over dt, which is step number 4. With a bit of algebraic maneuver, we can isolate dy over dt, which is 3 over 2 meters per second.
And that's going to be it for this video. Hope you liked it and hope it helped. In a separate video, I'll go over a wider variety of related rates problems, some of which might seem a bit more difficult, but like I said in this video, they all follow the same general pattern.
If you like this video, consider subscribing to my YouTube channel and also follow me on my other social media platforms.